हेलो एंड वेलकम टू दिस न्यू लेक्चर ऑन लैटिस बोल्ट्जमैन मेथड। सो कंटिन्यूइंग फ्रॉम वेयर वी लेफ्ट लास्ट टाइम, टुडे आई विल टॉक अबाउट प्रेशर बाउंड्री कंडीशंस एंड वी हैव ऑलरेडी कंसिडर्ड हाउ टू इम्पोज द वेलोसिटी बाउंड्री कंडीशन इन द लास्ट लेक्चर। ओके सो So what I'll talk about today is a case where let's say we are modeling flow in a channel. And we have to, let's say we are given some pressure value, or the pressure is specified at maybe the inlet or the outlet. So in this case, let me say that the inlet pressure is specified. Which means we are dealing with, you know, this section right now. And also for the sake of keeping the discussion, you know, tangible in the right direction, let me also define again the discrete velocity set, because we will be using that to calculate our distributions. So this is again d2q9. Okay, so this is a situation. We have a problem where the pressure is specified, so let me just define some representative lattices at the inlet. Now, when pressure is specified, now because in LBM, the pressure is actually given as a linear function of density. So specifying pressure basically means we are specifying density. So you can say that the density is given at a section. Okay. Now, so if I look at the problem, very similar to the way we tackled it in the last lecture. So we have a situation that post-streaming, let's say at this inlet, this is the inlet section, post-streaming we will have a few distributions that would have reached this inlet node, and these distributions will be F2, F3, F4, F6 and F7. So these would have arrived from the bulk of the domain. And what I'm now saying is that at the inlet, we're giving some density. So some density is specified, which of course will then be summation F alpha. The problem is, or the objective here is, to calculate the distributions, let's say F1, F5, and F8. Knowing the information or some information at the inlet. So how do we go about doing this? So similar to, so this is again, I'm referring to the paper by Zhao and He that I mentioned in the last lecture. So we can again go about trying to set up a set of linear equations. So we'll set up linear equations to be able to calculate or to determine F1, F5, F8. And what would these linear equations be? So let's go with the first condition, which is the density. So we'll have F1 plus F5 plus F8 to be equal to rho in minus F0 plus F2 plus F4 plus F3 plus F6 plus F7. Okay, so everything except three distributions will actually show up on the right hand side. So this will be my first equation between the unknowns. Now the second equation that I can write would be in terms of the momentum. So we can now say that summation F alpha C alpha X where again let me define the coordinates as x and y. So f alpha c alpha x should be equal to rho in ux, except you know the velocity, you know, may or may not be specified. So typically the kind of the problems that we are solving for in this situation, when you are specifying the density, the velocity is typically not known. Okay, so when you specify the pressure, the velocity is not going to be known. And typically, so this u velocity or the x component of velocity would be unknown. It's the same also goes with the outlet. Sometimes the outlet, you say that the pressure is given, and because of which the velocity has to be computed. So ux may not be known, and in which case, what we can do is, we can now write the momentum balance as, or the momentum equation as F1 plus F5 plus F8 to be rho ux plus F3 plus F6 plus F7. Now I can straight away see that if I combine 1 and 3, they have the same left hand side. So now I can combine, rather 1 and 2, I was saying 1 and 3, but it's 1 and 2. So if I combine, what I can now obtain is an equation for velocity. So I will get rho in 1 minus ux to be f0 plus f2 plus f4 plus 2 times f3, f6, f7, and so ux at the inlet would be 1 minus f0 plus f2 plus f4 plus 2 times f3, f6, f7 divided by the density at the inlet. So one of the unknowns, which is the velocity, can be computed using this simple technique. Now, one more thing that is a characteristic of most inlet or outlet boundary conditions are that either the velocity gradient would be zero, in which case from continuity for an incompressible fluid, dv dy is also zero. Okay, or we say that, so this will be typically true for an inlet. Let's say if you have a uniform inlet coming into a flow, and so you can say that the gradient of the velocity is nearly zero there, right? The upstream conditions are nearly zero, and so velocity is, so basically dv dy becomes zero. And it's also true for most outlet conditions. So if you keep the outlet very far away from the zone of action, we can say that du dx will be zero there, or that the flow would have reached fully developed conditions by the time it reaches the outlet, in which case again dv dy will be zero. Now if dv dy is zero, it basically means, if I go back to this geometry here, if dv dy is zero, it means v is not a function of y, which means v should be a function of x only. And now we can see that at each point, you know, or at the two walls along x, the velocity is zero, the v velocity will be zero at the two ends, because if the wall is impermeable, then in which case this condition also leads to v zero everywhere at the section. So I would say everywhere at this section. Okay, so we'll have v zero at such an inlet and outlet boundary node. Now, this is of course a simplification, but you could also have a situation where the velocity could be given. Let's say the flow is coming at an angle to the section, which can also be handled in a similar way. I mean, in the last lecture, we looked at that scenario, right, where the velocity was given, and it need not be that it only comes with one component. It can come with both components, or in three dimensions with three components. So needless to say, but if you have a pressure, we'll need some condition for velocity to be able to close the system of equations. And this is the condition that we typically take to close the system of equations. Of course, then there has to be a check. At the end of the calculation, you have to check whether this condition really gives you, you know, the physically realistic results. And that can be done by, you know, altering the location of the boundary. So you may actually want to move, let's say, the outlet even further away to see whether you get, you know, the same results or different results. If you get the same results, that means that the outlet is has been placed suitably. Now, if V0, coming back to this, if V0, I can now write that summation F alpha C alpha Y is 0, which will now give me F2 plus F5 plus F6, which are essentially distributions with the pointing in the upward direction, in the positive y direction. This should be equal to F4 plus F7 plus F8, which are distributions pointing in the downward direction. And before I label this as 3, I can just do one simplification. I know that F2 is something that in this problem I would know. Right, at this section F2 is known, but F5 and F8 are not known. So I will rather write this as F5 plus F8 to be F4 plus so I can now write this as F5 minus F8 to be F4 plus F7 minus F2 plus F6. So that gives me the third equation. Now we apply the same assumption that the non-equilibrium part of the distribution normal to the boundary is reflected. So we apply bounce back of the non-equilibrium part of distribution which is normal to this boundary. So in our case, the normal distribution would be F2, or rather F1 and F3. Okay, so this would mean I can now write F1 minus F1 equilibrium to be F3 minus F3 equilibrium, and I know that F1 equilibrium would be W1 into rho in, knowing that the density is given there, into 1 plus 3 ux, because ui or v is 0, plus 9 by 2, or rather not ui is 0, but rather because the vector e vector or the phase velocity vector along that direction is has only x component. So plus 9 by 2 ux square minus 3 by 2 ux square plus ui square. Of course, ui square is 0. We have already taken that, so I don't need to worry about this. Now, there is a problem in the last lecture. I have mistakenly put here a factor of 1. Actually, it should have been 3. So this should be 3 by 2, okay? Because there is a c square in the denominator, which goes as 3 in the numerator. So I'd just like to point that out, if somebody may have noticed that. So W3 into rho n, 1 minus 3 ux plus 9 by 2 ux square minus 3 by 2, again ux square plus ui square, where again ui square goes to 0. Okay, so now we have, if I now compare, or if I now put this back into the bounce back condition, I will have F1 minus F1 equilibrium, which will be W1 rho in 1 plus 3 ux plus 9 by 2 ux square minus 3 by 2 ux square, to be equal to F3 minus W3 rho in 1 minus 3 ux plus 9 by 2 ux square minus 3 by 2 ux square. And now we can start dropping off some terms. So we'll have this 1 will cancel here, and 9 by 2 ux square will cancel, and this will also cancel. And so what we'll be left with would be F1 to be F3 plus, we'll have the negative, and this negative will become positive on the right hand side, and we'll have a negative coming to the right hand side, so that becomes positive. So plus 2 by 3 rho in ux, if I use W1 to be W3, which is 1 by 9. And so now we have specified one distribution in our problem. And so this can be substituted back into the second equation, and into the third equation, and by a suitable manipulation I can now obtain, and I'm again leaving this to you to figure out. Of course, it's the idea is that going, you know, if you look between 1 and 2, or rather between 2 and 3, between 2 and 3, if I have, if you see here, I have f5 minus f8 here in 3, and I have f5 plus f8 here, so I can just add 2 and 3. If I add them together, I will just be able to eliminate f8. I have already computed f1, and everything on the right hand side is known, so I can then rearrange. And so what I would obtain would be f5 to be f7 minus half f2 minus f4 plus 1 by 6 rho in ux. That's the second distribution. And then finally, f8 to be equal to f6 plus half f2 minus f4 plus 1 by 6 rho in ux. Well, again, please remember that rho in, or density, is what is specified. Ux is computed from this equation. So this method can then allow us calculation of the distributions, the unknown distributions at a boundary where an inlet condition or an outlet condition is given. And now I can show you one case where this can be very easily applied. For instance, if you were modeling, let's say we were trying to model flow in a domain, okay, which has, let's say it has some inlet velocity given. Okay, we have u to be, let's say some velocity is given and v is 0, and let's say the two boundaries are top and wall, bottom boundaries are walls, and I give you pressure at the outlet. So I say, let's say this is the pressure is given, P is equal to P out. Okay, and I say that here, let's say du dx is 0, that the flow is fully developed. And I say these are walls, so u is 0, v is 0, u is 0, and v is 0. So I ask you to now compute how the flow will, you know, it will change, or the, how the velocity profile will change in this system. So now this actually seems like a very fairly standard problem. You know that the flow will actually, you know, in the core, the flow will accelerate, but towards the wall, the flow will slow down, so it will go to zero velocity. So now you can actually obtain velocities of the type, if I draw in terms of sections, let's say, right? So we can obtain some velocities which you should expect. So you will get maybe flows like that, you know, flatter towards the center, toward near the inlet. As you go down, maybe they get more rounded. And by the time you are very close to the outlet, maybe you get some kind of a parabolic flow. So we can actually obtain solution to a problem of this kind using these kinds of boundary conditions. Okay, so I will stop this lecture here. Now in the next lecture, I will actually move into some theoretical aspects of the Boltzmann equation. Much of the implementation that I could discuss, I have given so far for single phase flows. The implementation is, or the rather the theoretical aspects is, are where I will actually discuss a lot more about the background of LBM. So thank you for listening, and see you next time.